News 5 Live. Last murder of 2021 happens in Belize City as family prepared to ring in 2022. Officer charged after brutal New Year's Eve video goes viral. Sugar crop begins after weeks delay. And meet the New Year's babies born at the KHMH. Details of these stories and more coming up in tonight's newscast.
We have been a partner with SMART for over 10 plus years. We have a full SMART plan we use for as our major driver for our business. We have a service that rolls over in that if you call one and it is busy, it rolls over to the next line. So once you call us, you can get us at any time. Before we got this SMART service, we were paying upwards of nearly $2,000 in phone bills. Since we've had our SMART service, we pay an average of about $600. So we've had tremendous saving, more than 50%. For the businesses, if you want to save money, switch to SMART because it is far more cost effective and the service is excellent.
SMART continues to be innovative in bringing new technology and meaningful savings during these challenging times to businesses across Belize. Sign up for our VoIP technology or broadband packages and save more.
What if the profits of your bank were shared equally with you instead of with unknown shareholders and large corporations? What if those profits remained in Belize to enrich the communities where we live? What if just having an account with your bank meant that you were now a part owner of that bank? What if your voice mattered and you had a say in how your bank is being run? What if your bank was always looking out for your best interest and its biggest goal was to see you succeed? That's what it means to be part of a credit union where all of our members are in this together. Communities work best when they work for each other. Cooperation strengthens us all. Discover the credit union difference and find out just how stronger we can be together.
Disinfectant spray is certified by a U.S. EPA compliant lab to kill the coronavirus that causes COVID-19. Beep for a happy, healthy home.
Galenia Hospital, located in Cancun, Mexico's premier premier tourism destination is a state-of-the-art healthcare facility that provides highly specialized medical services. We are Quintana Roo's biggest private hospital with board-certified doctors and staff. Some of our services include cath lab, adult intensive care unit, neonatal intensive care unit, emergency rooms, operating theaters, ambulance services, and more. We are a medically accredited hospital by JCI, Accreditation Canada International, and General Health Council, providing extraordinary care in every specialty, from our cardiology department to our neurology center. We are focused on treating the entire person, body, mind, and spirit. Contact us at medicaltourism@hospitalgalenia.com or visit our website at www.hospitalgalenia.com. Come to Galenia Hospital in Cancun for a truly personal medical care experience.
Welcome to News 5 Live for Monday, January 3rd. I am Sabrina Daly. While the country was preparing to welcome 2022, the occasion was ruined for one family whose loved one was gunned down on the lane across from his home in Belize City. News 5's Marion Alley has the details of the last recorded murder of 2021, the one that claimed the life of Akeem Welch.
33-year-old Akeem Welch had just left home on Rivera Street, where his other siblings were gathered on Friday night in anticipation of the new year. But their plans were dashed when gunshots rang out sometime around 8:40 p.m. on Waite Street, a street that runs parallel to where they live.
We left here at Frontier to drink with my cousin and my friends. We was upstairs, like quarter to nine, we hear like about six shots.
The Welch family thought that because of the time of year, the blasts they heard were firecrackers. They soon found out that not only was it a murder that was just committed, but that the victim was one of them.
We say maybe they buy the test their gun, because I know they usually be shot for New Year's Eve. Not knowing my brother-in-law come and say, man down. So I say, make a peep through my window, and when I look, I see lone police lights. So I tell my mama somebody must get shot. Running on the scene, my brother me done in at the police truck.
Police responded to shots fired on Waite Street, Belize City. Upon their arrival, they saw the motionless body of Akeem Welch, 33 years, Belizean labor of Rivera Street, and a motorcycle was seen thrown on the street. Investigation revealed that he was at a yard and he left. And shortly thereafter, shots were heard and he received injuries to the body.
Welch was pronounced dead upon his arrival minutes later at the Carl Hirschner Memorial Hospital. While the police have no suspects or motive for the killing, his family believes that Akeem's killing was premised on his other siblings' affiliations.
He got two younger brothers and they were hanging at different sides. And they maybe they brother them more, but remember you can't catch how you catch a shot.
Police have taken statements and are gathering information in an effort to make an arrest. Reporting for News 5, I'm Marion Alley.
A young man lost his life New Year's Eve in an accident on the Southern Highway. 26-year-old Louis Ba died when his bicycle was hit by two men on a motorcycle. When police responded to the scene, they saw a motorcycle one side of the road. A short distance away, two men were observed suffering from head wounds. On the opposite side was a bicycle, and not too far away was an individual later identified as Ba, in an unconscious state. with a cut wound on his left leg. They were all transported to the Punta Gorda Hospital, where Ba succumbed to his injuries. Senior Superintendent Ilberto Romero is the deputy head of the National Crimes Investigation Branch.
Friday, the 31st day of December 2021, police responded to a road traffic accident on the Southern Highway. Upon their arrival, these three persons, Henry Coy, Efrain Shaw, and Luis Ba, with injuries to their bodies. Information is that Henry Coy was driving a motorcycle when he collided into a bicycle that was being ridden by Luis Ba. Luis Ba and the others were taken to the Punta Gorda Hospital, where Luis Ba died the day after receiving treatment. Investigation into this matter continues. The information has that Henry Coy lost control of the motorcycle and he hit the bicycle, causing the injuries to himself and to the victim.
A brawl near BTL Park involving a police officer and a civilian has resulted in charges being brought against 34-year-old Philip Garbutt. On Sunday, Edmond Perdomo was at an establishment in the vicinity when he got into a verbal exchange with the policeman who was on duty at the premises. It quickly escalated into a physical altercation, during which Garbutt produced his service weapon and proceeded to pistol whip Perdomo, causing injuries to his face. Amateur video capturing the incident shows a group of people engaged in an all-out brawl on the sidewalk, not far from Shisha Bar and Grill.
And on Sunday, the second day of January 2021, Edmond Perdomo reported that he was at Shisha Bar and Grill, located on Yutong Box, when he got into a confrontation with a police officer. Thereafter, they had a scuffle and the police officer took out his weapon and hit him to the face. He received injuries and was issued with medical funds. Thereafter, taken to the hospital, where his injuries were classified as wounding. Philip Garbutt, 34 years, Belizean police officer from Belize City, has since been arrested and charged for the crime of wounding. PC Garbutt had a talk with Perdomo, which escalated into a scuffle, and thereafter that is what led to this incident. They had a confrontation in the establishment.
Was the driver on duty at the establishment, or was he a proprietor?
He was working the other time.
10 days after Keenan Young died on Christmas Eve at the Belize Medical Associates, a post-mortem was conducted on his body to determine what caused the death of the 16-year-old. The family has suspected that a hit to his head back on December 8 at the hands of his older sibling was what caused his death. But the result of the autopsy certified that the minor died due to acute respiratory failure, due to acute pulmonary edema, pending histological and toxicology studies. Coming up, sugarcane trucks roll into the mill at Tower Hill. Details of the opening of sugar crop when we return.
Taking its name from the venerable father of the nation, the George Price Highway stretches 77 miles from Belize City to Benque Viejo. Originally built in the 1930s, this cross-country highway system is the artery that links Belize to Central America at the western border with Guatemala. That connection facilitates overland trade, supporting Belize's economic development. Winding its way across the scenic countryside, the George Price Highway, from Roaring Creek to Esperanza, has been fully reconstructed to meet international standards, with particular emphasis on road safety. A shorter and hassle-free commute is best enjoyed when everyone obeys the traffic laws. To reduce the number and frequency of road traffic accidents, it means that a seatbelt must be worn at all times and the speed limit observed when traveling along the highway. It also means that pedestrians must use sidewalks and crosswalks where available. Buses should only board and discharge passengers at a designated bus stop. Road safety is everyone's responsibility. It begins with you.
welcome to the good life.
Like we always do at this time.
Where you will find quality and savings on these products and more, only at Benny's. Celebrating 75 years of quality and savings.
The sugar crop finally got off to a smooth start today. As we have been reporting, the delay was caused mainly by a dispute involving the largest sugarcane farmers association in the industry and the sugar mill, ASR-BSI. The sugarcane farmers are seeking to negotiate a new commercial agreement with the mill. But because the current CA expires on January 19th and ASR-BSI was not prepared to enter into a negotiation on certain issues, an interim agreement had to be signed between both parties. The interim agreement extends the current CA up until the end of the crop, while giving both parties time to negotiate a new agreement. But the signing of the interim agreement brought about its own tensions, which led to a week of protests and farmers erecting a blockade in front of the mill. A compromise was struck on New Year's Eve, which led to the signing of the agreement. Today, when we visited the mill, those trucks that were blocking the gates were now carrying cane inside to be processed.
Today, well, you can see the crop already begin. It began before the 10 o'clock hour. And we are very happy now that we met an agreement, an interim agreement for the cane farmer to deliver their cane up to the end of crop, no? Because that's what we were standing up for. And also, I would like to thank publicly the cane farmers that sacrificed with us. Also, the different businesses that supported, and also the unions that supported also with us. You know, I will talk the nationwide too, the people, and especially to the government, the PM, along with the intervention of the four ministers that we had, Mr. May and Mr. Cervantes, Mr. Florencio Marin, and Mr. Rami Ramirez, no? And because we are already, that day when I announced until Monday, like today we will be dealing with the interim agreement, but the intervention of the ministers and the PM, well, overnight they worked it, and we were happy when they announced to us that we will be meeting grounds on the agreement the other day, the next day. So to our surprise, when that was called to us, even the PM went to the BCFA office to deliver me a document that if any legal would go against the BCFA of what's happening, they will take it in their hands, no?
But did cane farmers use undue pressure to get ASRBSI to sign an interim agreement, as some would suggest? ASRBSI on Thursday referred to the actions of the farmers as illegal tactics. We asked Westby for a response.
I believe it's not a bullying tactics, no. It's just that the farmer wanted to assure their payments for their cane, and they're also worrying about their production to go in, because if that don't go in, then you know their financial status could be in jeopardy, you know, and also we don't want that to happen. And they are very interested because they have bills to pay and they have family to maintain. So I believe they're standing up, and what they did is not is bullying, it's just that they showed us serious and they want what is theirs and what is justified for them.
And while the focus at this point is on ensuring that the sugar cane in the field makes it to the factory in as efficient a manner as possible, the road to signing a new commercial agreement is still ahead.
We know when you sit down to deal with an agreement, it already take 5 months, and we haven't met a mutual ground on the agreement because we are bringing a new way of payment of cane, no? And we know that will take time to debate. But what we were interested is that the farmers could deliver the cane, because we don't want cane to stay in the field. So while we are debating on that or negotiating on the current agreement, well, we wanted an interim so that the farmers could go ahead with the crop, no?
Will you hold up on all your issues related to the commercial agreement, even if BSISR says they can't negotiate on some points?
Well, I mean, I will leave that to when we are on the table, no? To when that time comes, well, then we'll see what will work out. But certainly you guys will know, and the nation will know what will transpire, no? But we'll leave that to when the time comes, we'll sit down and we'll see what will work out for us, for the benefit of the industry and our farmers, and also the mill, no? Because we don't want one to take advantage over the other. But an agreement that will suitable for the both side, justified for the both side, and for the industry to flow, and because we are not right now in Belize right now for the industry to be losing money. And the cane is very important also for us, the farmer, because that's our livelihood, and that's where we maintain our family and children, and we don't want that to be hampered.
After the break, they care for COVID patients from all over Belize. But what happens when medical personnel themselves call in sick at the Carl Huechner Memorial Hospital? We'll tell you how the hospital is handling this and about the new sick leave guidelines from the Ministry of Health when we return. But first, here's a look at the latest COVID-19 figures.
We'll be right back. best mobile experience in Belize? You don't know? Well, the truth is, Digi, our national telecom, of course. Digi has the largest mobile LTE advanced network with over 96% countrywide coverage, offering the fastest mobile LTE data speeds at the most affordable rates with mobile plans that fit your lifestyle. The truth is, only Digi gives the ultimate mobile LTE experience. Visit your nearest Digi store to join the bigger, better network today. Digi, our national telecom. Visit us online at www.livedigi.com.
The spirit of Christmas is about humbling ourselves, looking beyond the challenges and differences, and uniting as a family we truly are. As we reflect on the past year, let us be grateful for all that we have endured and look ahead with optimism for the upcoming year. We are thankful for all that we have been able to accomplish during the past year, especially our vaccination and wellness day held in June. It is through your support that these activities are possible and allow us to continue serving you. I encourage you to take the COVID-19 vaccine and urge you to continue taking the necessary precautions to keep yourself and your family safe. We are saddened that for another year, we will not be able to host our annual Christmas event. Make the Christmas catch you in a good mood. It is these opportunities that we look forward to interact with you and engage with you, our clients. However, your health, safety, and wellness comes first. May the spirit of Christmas infuse your life and that of your family and friends with hope, positivity, and joy. From the Board of Directors, Management, Staff, and Agents of RF&G Life Insurance, have a blessed and safe Christmas and a fruitful New Year 2022.
You inch your way to the edge of the board. Once you leap, there's no turning back. Your heart begins to race. You need to make a decision. Are you in or out? Join us for our brand new series where we dive deep into what it looks like to make God our Lord of all or not at all. God doesn't want just the dip of our toes or a wade in the shallows. He wants all of us. We're in or out.
Bundle the fastest, most reliable, unlimited broadband in Belize with your prepaid or postpaid mobile plan or Netflix. You can bundle your broadband with your prepaid and enjoy 50% off all national calls, plus get SMS and data. Paid plans? Then bundle with any speed and pay only $25 extra monthly to enjoy unlimited smart-to-smart calls, plus 500 minutes, plus 6,300 megabytes of data. Stream unlimited HD movies and TV shows with our broadband, plus the Netflix add-on for only $30 monthly, and enjoy streaming on your laptop, TV, phone, or tablet. Visit a smart showroom near you to sign up or upgrade to the bundle that's right for you. Smart, bringing people together.
management of the Carl Huechner Memorial Hospital Authority appeared on the Open Your Eyes morning show to discuss everything COVID. This includes the country commencing its fourth wave as active cases have been increasing by huge numbers daily. While it has not been officially announced, health experts do believe that the spike is indicative that the Omicron variant is in Belize and spreading quickly. Increasing COVID-19 cases adds pressure to the healthcare system. So, how ready is the KHMH for this eventuality?
There has been a decrease in the number of persons admitted to the COVID unit up to Friday. It was actually an opportunity for us to, you know, get prepared for this inevitable fourth wave. But since then, the numbers have slowly been increasing. Actually, on Saturday, we had up to 21 patients. We went from, I think it was 12 to 21. A lot of these are persons under investigation, so they're not confirmed COVID. And then yesterday, up to yesterday evening, we have 16 persons admitted to the COVID unit, of which 7 are positive and 9 are persons under investigation.
Certainly there was a lot of experience garnered in that second year. Mm-hmm. What we have seen is that as the expertise improved and as the equipment available became more abundant, we were able to get better outcomes. There was a large decrease in the percentage of deaths. We had a lot more people going home back to their families. And so that was a positive. All of that, of course, occurred against the backdrop of staffing difficulties and the shortages of supplies, which thankfully we have been able to more or less move forward with solving.
The capacity for the COVID unit at the KHMH is 27, but with the available human resources, the unit can best care for 18 patients at any given time. As it currently stands, there are 16 persons in the COVID unit. About 7 of those persons are minors. Dr. Andres Sosa also says that the younger, obese population are more at risk, and the increase is concerning with the reopening of schools next week.
I think it's noteworthy that with this rush that we saw over the weekend, mm-hmm. that at least 6 or 8 of the patients were minors under 18 years of age. Mm-hmm. So already that tells us that a younger population is now more susceptible. Certainly, we continue to see the persons with comorbidities and the unvaccinated coming in, but also now we have younger individuals, which is sort of worrisome, mm-hmm. particularly since we are on the brink of school openings, mm-hmm. and given the fact, of course, that the under 12s still are not being vaccinated. So
yeah.
That is something that the experts will have to grapple with.
Yeah. I've seen reports in the U.S. where they're seeing more hospitalization in children. So it's interesting that you note that here as well. And we're still seeing younger persons getting hospitalized as well. We started to see that with Delta, or too
yes,
early to tell.
Yes, and it would be primarily the obese, mm-hmm. Younger individual. Okay. So that's a big, big risk factor.
COVID-19 is non-discriminatory, and even healthcare professionals who have been working around the clock to save those who end up being hospitalized have fallen victim. We reported on the toll that the disease has had on the mental health of the staff, but there are also a number of doctors and nurses at the National Referral Hospital that are out sick due to COVID-19. So, how is the KHMH coping when its own employees are out sick?
Today we have about 8 or 9 of our doctors out sick, and perhaps about the same number of nurses who are out sick with COVID. So It is a fluid situation. We try to adapt. We try to do the best we can to protect our staff. I think Omicron is probably here, although I can't say that for certain. What is true, though, is that it has moved at blazing speed, and we were in the process of trying to give our staff some rest. Vacations were long overdue, and we are trying to prepare for this fourth wave, which has come like a tsunami. No, when there are less people to give the service, mm-hmm. frustration increases. So we tell our colleagues, our healthcare workers, safety first. Mm-hmm. Protect yourself. Don't rush into any situation mm-hmm. without first having taken the necessary precautions. Mm-hmm. And that those precautions must extend to beyond your workplace. Mm-hmm. And that's as much as you can do.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate, but there are instances, and I need to mention it, where people have become disgruntled and have become aggressive with our healthcare workers. And sometimes the very people that you would expect to behave appropriately. Mm-hmm. I just want to remind viewers and the public in general that we have to look at the safety of our healthcare workers, mm-hmm. because if there are no healthcare workers to provide the service, then who will paddle this dory?
Patients who become infected with the Omicron variant will be given fewer days in isolation than those who are infected with the Delta variant. This is because of the milder symptoms as well as its shorter time frame it takes to incubate in patients. A circular sent out by Deputy Director of Health Services, Dr. Francis Mori, today addressed to all regional health managers, their deputies, all chiefs of staff and surveillance teams on December 31st gave new guidelines. It states that to mitigate essential time lost, infected people who fall under the category of essential services who show no symptoms from the time they test positive will remain in isolation for 7 days instead of 10 days. The isolation time is also cut short for infected people who make up the general population who show no symptoms from the time they test positive. For essential workers who show no more symptoms after 3 days of testing positive, people who show mild symptoms of cough, fatigue, muscular aches, or headaches after the reduced isolation period can thereafter be given additional time off as a doctor who reassesses them sees fit. During his appearance on the morning show, Dr. Andres Sosa also said that he was disappointed in the fact that no frontline healthcare worker who has been in the trenches battling the COVID-19 public health crisis was bestowed with the Queen's New Year's honors. Just last week, several persons, including philanthropist Dara Robinson, BNTU National President Senator Elena Smith, and Dr. Marcela Coyi, were honored. Here's how Dr. Sosa puts it.
Despite the heavy toll that mm-hmm. working in the COVID unit has brought, our people never say no. Mm-hmm. They don't run away when they hear COVID, which is why I'm so disappointed that not one frontline worker was honored for the New Year's Queen's honors.
That's a very good observation.
So how is it possible that facing the worst crisis this country has seen since perhaps Hurricane Hattie, mm-hmm. or maybe even the 1918 pandemic, not one frontline worker has been honored. How is that possible? But anyway, that's my way of looking at it.
There's more news coming up, but first, here is a weather update with data from the Belize Met Service.
Thank you. The premier name in voice and data is also the country's leading provider of innovative services and solutions for small business and enterprise. At DigiBusiness, we offer solutions, tools, and applications to support your business needs. Reduce costs, improve efficiency, and excel in a changing world where no idea is too big and no task is too small. From technology advising to design implementation and management, our team of qualified solution sales and specialists can develop a reliable and robust infrastructure, allowing you to spend more time on what matters most, your business. Visit us online to explore how DigiBusiness innovative products and solutions can help your business reduce costs and improve efficiency.
Child Development Foundation, or CDF as we are popularly known, has been partnering with Social Security Board since 2015. Social Security Board supports our child protection initiatives. They support us to build capacity for teachers and parents to identify the indicators of abuse. In particular, they support our counseling center so that we can provide trauma-focused counseling therapy to children who have been abused. Social Security has also supported our prevention program, the Rise Girls program, to help us to equip young women who are in primary and secondary school to understand more about adolescent development and also to build good self-esteem and to build safe social networks.
Over the past 6 years, we have established a partnership with the Social Security Board. It has assisted us in addressing some of their social welfare needs and health care needs of our older persons, specifically in Belize City, San Ignacio, and Belmopan. We have had the opportunity to do home visits with our geriatrician and physiotherapists. We distribute meals to them. We also have that opportunity to interact with them, to observe them. There are needs that may be identified. If we can address those, we do so.
Social Security has been one of our biggest donors throughout the years, and the services that they provide to us is basically financial, and it helps with a lot of things here at the center, like bills and groceries. The center is a drop-in center for the mentally ill, elderly, homeless, deportees. They come here, they take a shower, they get their breakfast, they get their lunch, and they also do recreational stuff here at the center. They can watch television, they listen to music, they play games, and they just, you know, interact with each other because here it's like a family.
As you reflect on love and life during the Christmas season, think about this. On average, almost 70 Belizean sons, brothers, and fathers crash and die on our highways every year. Unsafe drivers also take the lives of innocent passengers, pedestrians, and cyclists. Now our young men are dying in motorcycle crashes. The top two reasons by far for all these deaths are negligence and loss of control. Join the Department of Transport, the Police Department, and the Road Safety Project this Christmas season in showing that you care about your passengers and other vulnerable road users on the highways. Drive a little slower. Drive with more attention and focus on safety. Be prepared for more traffic checkpoints as we work to reduce speed and eliminate drunk driving, making our roadways safer. This Christmas season, give the gift of life and make Belize feel the love. A message from the Second Road Safety Project.
It's a fact that your credit lasts longer when using Smart. During these times, we're all trying to find ways to cut costs and save the little resources we have. With Smart, it's easy to do that. It's a fact. that with Smart, your credit lasts longer. You can call Smart to Smart and Smart to Digi using your promo credit. While with the other guy, you can only call OnNet, Digi, or BTL numbers. What does this mean? You get to call any national number using your promo credit. Your promo credit is free, so that call is also free. Know your facts. Don't be tricked by the other guy. Be smart and save a dollar.
An application to strike out the redistricting case brought before the Supreme Court by the Belize Peace Movement has been filed by Senior Counsel Oscar Sabido, Chair of the Elections and Boundaries Commission. The matter went before the court in October 2019 and is scheduled to be heard in the coming weeks. But in his application, Chairman Sabido summarized two reasons, including the fact that the claimants failed to file witness statements when they were required to do so. Despite the setback, the court issued directives for both parties to negotiate, with a view to settling the matter. Nonetheless, the Elections and Boundaries Commission reportedly broke off the deliberations and rejected several proposals by the claimants for settlement. News 5 spoke with Paul Morgan, treasurer of the Belize Peace Movement.
The chairman of the Elections and Boundaries Commission filed an application to strike out the case, which is before the court, the redivisioning case before the court. His grounds were two. First, that the Elections and Boundaries Commission complains that the claimants did not file their witness statements in time. And in fact, that is true. The statements were filed 2 days late. But again, there was a problem with the portal, the court portal, why our attorney couldn't file on time. Actually, we sent a process server to physically file at the courts, but he couldn't do that because the court had already changed the system of filing. So we were 2 days late. The second reason the chairman gave was that they were already setting up administration to begin the redivisioning process. And those were his grounds. To that we say that setting up an administration to do redivisioning does not satisfy the requirements of the Constitution, which is to have the divisions near equal. It is like, Isani, if a man is hungry and he smells food, it is not good enough. He must eat food. Therefore, we need the redivisioning to happen. And I believe that the Honorable Court will see that simply setting up an administration and asking for the court to dismiss or strike out the case will not be enough. That we were late in filing, there is a good reason for that. And I ask that the public join us in clamoring for fair representation in this country as we go through this case.
According to Morgan, the present number of voters per constituency across all 31 electoral districts is malapportioned.
I've already proposed a consent order to the Elections and Boundaries Commission. They rejected it outright without any counter proposal, showing that they don't care about negotiations. And so we are at the point now of asking the court to make a determination, make a ruling as to say that the divisions at this point in time do not comply with the Constitution. The numbers in division do not comply with the Constitution. So with that, the Elections and Boundaries Commission has begun to set up administration, and they would like the court to throw it out because they have begun their setup. We find that quite disingenuous and disrespectful, and we would hope that they would reconsider even after they have filed their application, I don't think the court will entertain it.
36-year-old Brandon Katus is the 2022 Crème New Year's Day Men's Cycling Classic winner. Katus won from among a field of over 60 cyclists. Katus was in the first breakaway in the Corzal district, which included three other cyclists. He told News 5 that the four of them shared the station prizes for about 30 miles until they reached Orange Walk when his teammate, Derek Chavarria, and another cyclist caught them. They decided to use the same strategy, to share the station prizes along the rest of the route. And then at around mile 10, near the airport cutoff, his teammate Chavarria broke away from them. Katus caught up with Chavarria, who is under 23-year-old cyclist, around mile 8, and the two rode in together. He said Chavarria, who had a successful cycling year, agreed to let him have the title as they rode in together, hand in hand, to the tape. Katus's bike wheel edged out Chavarria's by only inches as they rode past the finish line. The 96-mile race, which was ridden along the Philip Gosen Highway from the Santa Elena border in Corozal to Belize City, has been ridden since 1990 and is second in popularity only to the Holy Saturday Cross Country Cycling Classic. Up next, ringing in the new year with a new baby, meet the little bundles of joy born over the holiday weekend when we return.
I set up my desk and I can input PAYE, contract tax, and income tax easily without printing papers anymore. I'm proud that my company jumped on this so fast to ease our workload when filing. What I like is the professionalism and the confidentiality the system provides. After registering the company, we only had to provide approval for staff to enter and have access. The tax service professional walked me through, answered questions, and got us ready for processing and paying online directly from our bank account, all from the portal. Tax processing that once took several days inclusive of payment now only takes a few hours. I'm also personally registered, which means my tax refund will also be paid directly to my bank account and I can track its process myself with my own login.
Iris Belize, effortless, easy and efficient electronic tax services for everyone.
My parents always said, when it's time to build, invest in quality products that last a lifetime, even if it means paying a little more. It is now my turn to invest in my own home, and it's not even a question. It has to be Oran Windows. My contractor recommends Oran because of the heavy-duty construction, the thickest gauge blades on the market, and the dual locks that allow lower louvers to close independently for privacy while the top remains open for airflow. These features make Oran aluminum louver windows the best on the market.
With Oran aluminum louver windows, you get strength, durability, and beauty with an added layer of security and protection against debris and damaging winds. Come in and check out the variety of sizes and colors at Design Depot, located at Mile 3 Philip Gosen Highway in Belize City.
The ministry is collaborating with SpeedNet Communications to have a vaccination campaign for children ages 12 to 17 years. Children who get vaccinated will get a chance to win fabulous prizes, including backpacks with supplies, Nintendo Switch, tablets, book tuitions, and MiFi with 3 months data. Only children 12 to 17 years old can participate in this Smart and Ministry of Health and Wellness raffle. At vaccination sites, each vaccinated child, upon being vaccinated, will receive a ticket to place their name, age, date of birth, BHIS number, and contact information on, which will be filled out by a parent or legal guardian. The sooner a person vaccinates, the more chances he or she will have to win. Get vaccinated, Belize! Vaccination saves lives.
Thank you.
does the AstraZeneca vaccine work? The vaccine provides support to help your body develop immunity to the virus that causes COVID-19. The body is left with a supply of memory cells that will remember how to fight the virus. It takes a few weeks for the body to produce the antibodies after vaccination. How long does it take to build immunity after taking the first dose of the vaccine? There is protection 14 days after a person's first dose. However, that initial protection may decline over time, which is the reason why it is so important to get the second shot. How long after the first dose should one take the second dose? The second dose should be given between week 8 and week 12. Are there any deaths associated with the AstraZeneca vaccine? There have been no deaths associated with the AstraZeneca vaccine. Vaccines save lives. They remain the safest, most effective, and cost-effective medical tool developed. Increased uptake of the vaccine is the best way to stop this pandemic, save lives, and return to normalcy.
Born baby boy and baby girl for 2022 at the KHMH. They were born hours apart at the Carl Hueschner Memorial Hospital, but are blessings for this new COVID year. The baby boy was the fourth child of Joselie Estrada, whose family is still undecided on his name at this time, while the baby girl, Shaya, was a first experience for her mother, Shala. News 5's Dwayne Moody reports.
I feel excited because then he's a blessing to us and he makes everyone happy. Even though it's not my first, but the whole entire family accept him and happy to have him in the family. And that's what I'm happy about.
I feel really excited. I'm nervous because I never know what to expect. I'm tired. I'm just happy I get it over with at the all. I don't know, I just happy to have my baby.
These two bundles of joy are blessings during yet another year of the COVID-19 pandemic, but they are also the first born boy and girl for the new year at the KHMH. The first baby was born at 9:39 a.m. on January 1st and is the fourth child of Joselie Estrada. They have not chosen a name as yet, but Dwayne is being highly favored. We met Estrada at home, who says she was worried about having a baby during the pandemic.
On the 31st, I went in. With no kind of pain. I had contraction, yes, but no pain at all. Till I was in the hospital, they admitted me, told me I had 3 centimeters, and I was like, okay, so maybe I can go home with the 3 centimeters. They told me, no, ma'am, I had to stay in. I was kind of excited, because I said, well, the baby would have come the 31st, not the first. One time I looked, they put drips on me, and at 4 centimeters, I jumped from 4 to 8 centimeters, from 7 to like around 8:15, 8:30. By 9:39, I delivered my wonderful son. And I hear this screamer and told me, wow, it's a year, the first baby for 2022. It's a you have the New Year's baby. The tears I burst into was the tears of joy.
Inside the maternity ward at the KHMH, a number of mothers are awaiting their discharge from the facility, including the third baby born on New Year's Day. Shaya is the first born girl of the year. It was an emotional time for her mother, 20-year-old Shala Smith.
My original due date, I'm in the 26th, but due to, I don't know, they never make a gun in the 26th. I don't come in the 26th, I come in the, they tell me if you come in the 27th, and I mean I had baby the 28th, but due to I never did swab, and I had to come back again, get a new date again, so then they give me, they tell me the 31st to come in. So I come in the 31st day. I never want to come on and at all. It just made the pain me until they give me the pills and they say, see me out. Love. Joy, happiness, when I catch cold, see that now. And I just happy this that all I ever want.
Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, all the bells and whistles could not happen for their New Year's welcome.
Well, 2022 has seen, for the first time in the 8 years that I've been there, babies being born this late. So Josely's baby was born at 9:39. Normally, for the New Year's baby, it is right after 12. It is at 1:30 in the morning. These babies seem to not want to see 2022. It's a little disturbing. So we had our first child at 9:39. I think the other child was born at 10:30. And we had three births for that day, two male and a female.
Dwayne Moody for News 5.
And that's the news. Tonight's broadcast is available in both text and streaming video at channel5belize.com. You can also connect with us on our Facebook page at facebook.com/news5live. I'm Sabrina Daly. Thanks for joining us. And from all of us here at News 5, please remember to wash your hands, keep your social distance, and stay safe. Good night.